So I think the first thing is to make sure people know that the way you're doing something now isn't wrong, right? That there's reasons, there's things going on that are driving the change, not that you are driving the change. I think sometimes we come in and we say, we gotta do something different. And it's like, I think everybody out there says, well, why? Like, we're, you know, obviously we love our jobs. We are feeling every day we're showing up for work and we're feeling like we're giving our, you know, best for this, you know, what is wrong with this? And I think, so I think that's the first thing. You have to come in and say, this is not about that you're doing something wrong. This is about, here are the things that are going on that we're trying something new and we will see. And because of these things, it kind of goes back to the win-win, because we're trying to give you maybe the potential for different kind of work, that there's a win out there for them too with the change, right? I think that's also very important. You have to get people to buy in to some level, and you have to recognize that buy-in really will probably only happen with some small wins. You know, people will be skeptical at the beginning, and you have to put some small wins out there for them to be able to see, and you will probably have to point out to them, sometimes it will be so small that they may not, you know, recognize them as wins at the time, right? But what I have seen is that when people start recognizing the wins and the potential and how doing things in a particular way and how the change is helping them, that's really where I think that really then change becomes permanent. Because if people don't buy into it, it's like a, you know, like you've just did a rubber band and they'll spring back to the original shape, you know, right after that initial momentum goes, and you really haven't changed the trajectory at all. It's very, very important to, it may take a little bit more time, but you'll have a permanent change if you kind of make sure everybody's going towards you. So that takes a lot of trust, right? So trust and communication kind of go hand in hand. And it's really, really important when you're in those times of big change where you really, I think one of the toughest things, and I've seen it as I've gone up in management, is to make sure that you have the right communication paths, right? And you're hearing when there's people that are 6 miles behind you, right? And so that you can go back and you can, you know, go talk to them and find out what's going on to hold them back, right? And then go figure out how do you get them to see the benefit in it, right? It does take a lot of cat herding sometimes, but it's very, very important. When I came into the space station program, we were really beginning joint operations with the Russians. And there was a lot of distrust between the both of us about really, can the Russians do it? I mean, the Russians thought we were idiots too, right? It was about both of us kind of learning. But over time, we gained so much respect from each other about the different ways each of us did it that actually had pros and cons to them along the way. And so that's kind of evolved. And then we began working with ESA, and then we began working with JAXA. And for each one of those, there was this initial hesitancy about, can they really do it? Can they really do it? And obviously, if you go look at that history from an international perspective, our international agreements and space station wouldn't be where it is today without our international partners. And have they shown they can do it? Absolutely, they've shown they can do it. But people were so skeptical along the way. And I remember when I started, we were working commercial cargo, and the same type of thing, but now it was a little bit different. It was like, oh, yes, governments can do it. So we evolved to governments can do it, but can private industry, if you give them more responsible, can they really do it on their own, right? Or can they do that with less oversight or insight from NASA? And so really when we started cargo, it was a little bit of our experiment to say, let's back off on some of this stuff and see, can they still do it? Like, can they still do it? And And as we see now, I mean, over 100,000 pounds of cargo have been delivered to the space station program. I mean, really, commercial cargo is really what's changed. It enabled us post-shuttle to really evolve the space station program to the science capability it is there today. And it's because really of industry. It's because industry stepped up and they've done it. And it's not that they didn't have problems. They absolutely did. We had one of the things I'm most proud of is we had two cargo failures and they kept going. Both of them flew within a year after that cargo failure. It did not stop them. I'm hoping to continue to kind of push and maximize the benefit of these relationships going forward, because we're going to need them when we go to the moon and when we try to go to Mars. Well, you know, what's really great is there's a lot jump in. I mean, there's lots of companies out there looking for you, right? But the other thing I tell people all the time and is think about what you're doing and how you can help us solve a problem, right? I think what's really cool is that there are space companies and there are companies that don't know they're space companies yet. And I tell industry out there, I'm like, you know, you may not know your space company yet, but it maybe if I tell you all my problems, you may find out that somewhere in there, you're a space company. So I think what's changed over time is that as we talk more about this and we make it less of a, you know, it used to be almost like you had to really be super duper, you know, like this unattainium, you know, to be a space company. And what we find out is, hang on a second, it's really about hard work, solving the problems, understanding what the problems, and I think that there's many industrial partners potentially out there that can solve our problems. So I'm hoping that I can put out what are our problems in space and hopefully jazz enough young people, middle-aged people, old people to go help us with these problems so that they come up with the solutions. You don't ever get a new solution set unless you bring in new providers. I really firmly believe that. And in some cases, it's what the crowd's taught us, right? It's like the whole spectrum. When you get the whole spectrum thinking about a problem, there may be somebody that's looking at it in a totally different way. And that's what kind of helps us. We in NASA, we're looking at our problems the same way. When we would go solve a problem, we go, oh, this is what we did in Apollo. Oh, this is what we did in this. And that was our roadmap, right? And honestly, with us working with international partners, us working with our commercial partners, guess what? We have lots of roadmaps now. So find your path. Yeah, I think, you know, the great thing about being at White Sands was as a fairly junior engineer, I was able to gain a lot of responsibility. And I ended up kind of, because the big problem we were solving at the time was how to figure out ways to make repair and refurbishment of hardware for the space, for the orbiter project in particular on the space shuttle program, how to make that more affordable for the space shuttle program. And so we started what we call the depot, where we started to bring in house work. But through that, you had to figure out how to partner with great companies like Aerojet and Rocketdyne and people that had built fantastic hardware for the space shuttle and go work with them in a collaborative way to be able to learn what they had learned to be able to do this tough thing, right? And it was very, very difficult because in some ways you're taking business away from them, but also needed them. And it was a really learning experience on how to work with people in difficult situations and be able to have knowledge transfer, work together but then also find new ways to collaborate. You know, we ended up doing work for Aerojet later, helping them actually refurbish and supply engines for their H2 and HTV capabilities that they had. And so it was through us having these relationships and being able to help each other that we could, you know, created opportunities for both of us. I also had to learn, I was the only NASA employee and had about, you know, 120 different contractors working for us, but you also realize how important it was that we operated as a badgeless community and really did not, we were all part of a team. And so that concept of forget about what my badge says, we're the DEVO team became very, very strong too. And so I think, you know, having respect and being able to not look at what your badge is saying, but what you're trying to do, and finding places where you align was a major management learning experience for me. Well, I think the most exciting thing to me is it's not just about NASA. I think it's about what industry is bringing forward too, right? And I'm really, in my mind, trying to change what we're doing to be, I want NASA to be a catalyst, but I want us also to hear from industry what their big problems are. Instead of this just being a one-way conversation, what I'm really hoping is that we start having a dialogue and we start hearing from industry, what are your big problems, so that not only are you solving our problems, but maybe we're helping you solve yours too.